So this matchup here, this is our prediction show. And, we, you know, of course, we're going to jump into the keys of the game and all of that fun stuff. But the first thing I want to talk about, Bryan, is what's at stake in game three for Notre Dame? Because I don't know that if 3 weeks ago you and I are having this discussion prior to the Purdue game about what's at stake. Look, Notre Dame is 2-0. We assumed that they would be 2-0, but I don't think that 2-0 has arrived in the manner in which we thought.
Didn't look like the 2-0 we expected.
That is correct. So going into the Purdue game, look, Purdue can beat Notre Dame. They can beat Notre Dame. I mean, the last two teams that played Notre Dame could beat Notre Dame. One went into overtime. One was the last second drive to win, right? So
yeah.
Purdue can beat Notre Dame. So my question to you is, what's at stake here in week three before, you know, Notre Dame even gets to that stretch that everybody's been talking about? We're not even there yet, but what's at stake right now against the Purdue Boilermakers at home?
Well, I mean, obviously the biggest picture of what's at stake is Notre Dame's playoff chances are at stake. I mean, that's kind of the case every week, right? And, sure, and we didn't expect this game to be one that I mean, look, Purdue can knock some people off. Purdue knocked Ohio State out of the playoff in 2018, right, with a beatdown. But that's just not who Purdue is on a normal basis. At least it hasn't been so far.
Right.
This is not a team that can stack up with Notre Dame talent top to bottom. They've got some really good players at the top, but Notre Dame has just as good, if not better, players at the top. This is a game where it's about, number one, big picture, the playoff aspect. But I think the more important thing, you know, there's the macro and the micro. On the micro level, to me, Vince, it's more of a what kind of momentum, what kind of attitude, what kind of mentality do you want to create for your football team? And I think that's what this Purdue game is all about. As you get ready for the Wisconsin, I mean, look, here's what comes up after this week. It's Wisconsin. It's Cincinnati. It's Virginia Tech, it's USC, and then it's North Carolina. That is your defining stretch of who you're going to be this season. You would ideally need to go into that stretch with a little bit of momentum and confidence. And I think this team needs a big confidence boost. They did not play with a ton of confidence against Toledo, which was surprising. And I think this is the kind of game where that confidence needs to be built. I think that ultimately is what's at stake. Because even if you win this game, which I expect Notre Dame to do. Neither of us are going to pull shockers and pick Purdue to win.
No.
Just kind of giving that away a little bit at the beginning. Hey,
giving it away, man.
It is to the concern for me is that if you come out of this game in similar fashion to what you came out of the last two games, you haven't improved as a football team, then you're in a part of the season where you're going to catch a few L's, a couple L's. And so to me, that's ultimately where this game, what's at stake in this game is what kind of momentum, what kind of identity, what kind of leadership, all those type of things that define your team. What do those look like? And you know, let's go back to 2017 and 2018. You know, 2017, Notre Dame was 1-1. They had a loss. Now they played a much better team than they've played so far. And I remember, Drew, we've talked about this before, but Drew Tranquil after the game says, boy, you know, I feel really bad for the teams about to face. And you could see that determination in his eyes and that team. And I've heard similar stories about, you know, Quentin Nelson and Mike McGlinchey and how they responded to that game. And then after that game, I did feel sorry for the teams that they played for the next 6-7 weeks because Notre Dame destroyed people. I mean, I don't think they played a competitive game until they lost to Miami. I mean, and then in 2018, Notre Dame gets a big win over Michigan, and then they struggled against a really bad Ball State team. Now, it wasn't as close to losing like it was against Toledo, but this Toledo team was also a whole lot better than that Ball State team.
Sure.
You know, and you sit and think, boy, this team just doesn't look right. Well, they righted the ship. They went out the next week against Vanderbilt, looked pretty bad again, lost, you know, won the game. You know, could have lost if the defense doesn't make a stop. It reminded me a lot of the Toledo game. Then you came out against Wake Forest, going the road against Wake Forest, and that team, again, that team kind of had, you had some changes in personnel. You had the quarterback change. That team kind of, from what I'm told, did a little bit of a gut check, Vince, and said, you know, hey, who do you want to be, fellas? And they went out that next week and smacked Wake Forest, went out the next week and destroyed Stanford, and then went on the road and had a 20-plus point victory over Virginia Tech, and then that team became another 12-0 team that went to the playoff. So how is this team going to respond to its adversity early in the season?
Right.
And that ultimately is what Saturday is going to be about for me. You're going into game three. You're going to basically be done with a quarter of your season after Saturday already. And what do you want to be? And so to me, it's about what kind of attitude do you have? What kind of physicality are we going to see from this football team? What kind of swagger are we going to see from this football team? I still expect mistakes to be made. I still expect the offensive line to have some missed assignments. I don't think they're going to all of a sudden look like the 2017 O-line in 1 week. I think the defense will still probably have a couple mistakes and blown assignments, and those things are going to happen. They need to be less than they've been in recent weeks. But to me, Vince, it's more about the physicality, the fire, the passion, the accountability. That, sure, to me is more of what's at stake. If we don't see that, then we have to come to start coming to grips with the reality that maybe this team doesn't have the leadership that we thought it did. If we do see it on Saturday, regardless of the margin of victory, I'll start feeling a lot better about the direction that this team is headed.
Well, the one word that you used while you were, you know, talking there was identity.
And go ahead. You wanted to say it while you were going on and on and on. I saw it.
Your soliloquy. Okay. All right. How's that? We'll use a proper term. But it's identity. And I don't think this team has an identity yet. And I think they're still searching for it. And I think that this game, they can get a clearer picture as to what that identity is, right? I think the defense is still approaching a point where they're kind of getting an idea of what their identity is. And the offense, look, right now the offensive identity is throw the ball, keep Cone upright, and you're going to score points. But they need a clearer identity with the running game. I mean, they need to figure out what that's going to look like. Now, do I expect the run game to look like the pass game right now? I don't. And I don't think that that's going to be the identity of this offense. But in order for this offense to be more than one-dimensional, the run game has to come around, right? So I still think that this team's searching for an identity overall, and I think it's going to get clearer after this week. Whether mm-hmm. that's a positive thing or whether that's a negative thing, I think that we're going to have an idea, a better idea of who this team is going, you know, I guess kind of on the road to Chicago next week. After this game, I really do. You know, from a offensive play calling standpoint with Tommy Rees, from a defensive full game, can they, you know, shut down teams in the fourth quarter standpoint? You know, all of those different things, I think we're going to get some answers to those moving forward, because now Tommy Rees has two games worth of, you know, I don't want to say film because he was obviously there, but two games worth of knowing his guys and seeing, okay, what do I need to do to continue to put points on the board with the team that I have assembled right now, right? Now, there's some things, obviously, you can get the O-line better. There's some individual things you can do with the O-line. Mm-hmm. You know, you want them to get better, but they're not going to be a strength of this team. So what does the offensive play calling look like knowing that moving forward? Because we've had two games now. Two games is a trend, right? One game is an off thing. Two games is a trend, in my opinion. He knows what he's got. What's that going to look like, right? Are we going to see some more perimeter screens? Are we going to see, you know, Jack Cone getting the ball out a little quicker? You know, what does that package look like for Tyler Buckner? You know, all of those things. That's what I'm going to be keeping my eye on. What is this team identity coming out of week three?
Yeah, and you focus on some of the schematic and execution things, and for me, my focus is going to be on how you play. It's if Notre Dame isn't by far the most physical football team on the game on the field Saturday, that's where I'm going to be concerned. Again, if the offensive line has some technical, and we'll get into this, but if the offensive line has some mistakes, scheme mistakes or technique mistakes and those kind of things, but they battle, they play hard, they fight, they scrap, they claw, they get movement,
right,
I'm gonna feel a whole lot better about this offensive line,
no question.
And that's really the big thing for me, the lack of emotion on defense from a lot of guys on Saturday. Like, it wasn't that they were like not playing hard, it just was like it just didn't seem like they were playing with a great deal of confidence.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be the biggest thing for Marcus Freeman to figure out, is what can we do to get these group of players playing with the kind of fire that they need to play across the board. And there's a guy here. I mean, Jason Adamiola played with fire. I thought J.D. Bertrand did. I thought Cam Hart did early. But it's got to be everybody. And that's going to be the big thing for me.